Hi, my name is Skyla Rimple and I'm a freshman at Mashpee Middle High School and I'm a representative on the school committee. Today we are joined here by Senator Julian Cyr, who represents the Cape and Islands District for Massachusetts and the State Senate. Hello, Julian. How are you today?
Hey, Skyla. How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm good. It's good to be at Mashpee Middle High School.
Absolutely. Yeah. So to start, since your new term started in January, what legislation have you been working on and what is your role and committee assignments this season?
So the legislative session, the new session started in January. We have 2-year sessions, so we run, January through, you know, this is the start of the session. So the first thing that we do is we file bills. So over 8,000 bills have been filed in the legislature. I didn't file all that many. I filed 73 of them on a whole host of issues, right, from healthcare to the environment, a lot of things that matter to Cape Codders. And then the second piece that happens is that committee assignments are made. And so we have a new Senate president in the state Senate, a woman by the name of Karen Spilka, who's from Ashland, Metro West Town. And she's our new Senate president. She's wonderful. And I was very, very humbled to be appointed to chair the Joint Committee on Mental Health, Substance Use, and Recovery. So this is the committee that is charged with looking at how do we improve our mental health care system, how do we address addictions and mental illnesses. And then I also was appointed as the Assistant Majority Whip, which is a leadership position. You're probably like, what's that? What's a whip? So you help, the position you help to get a sense of the caucus, a sense of the body on a whole host of issues. So I get to serve in the Senate President's leadership team, the top 8 lawmakers in the Senate who help advise her on the direction of the Senate. So it's a pretty big, it's a big appointment. It's something I feel really, really privileged to be able to be. And I really get to make sure that Mashpee and all of Cape Cod and Nantucket and Martha's Vineyard that I represent, that we really have a seat at the table when the Senate is talking about a whole host of issues, right? From criminal justice to education reform to transportation to mental health parity. I get to be kind of in the room where it happens and at that table. So something that, really hopefully will help the region.
Yeah, that's awesome. So you recently...
It is awesome. That's pretty cool. Yeah.
You recently hosted a town hall meeting on energy and environmental issues on the Cape, and we recently just celebrated Earth Day earlier this week. So what are you working on for those issues?
So this was a town hall that my colleague, Representative Sarah Peake, and I convened to talk about, basically to take stock of all the environmental and energy legislative efforts and policies that we're trying to advance. And there's a whole host of them.
Yeah.
One bill I filed is a community empowerment bill, which basically provides a tool for communities to opt in to purchase and support renewable and green energy projects.
Yeah.
You could have a say in Mashpee to say, all right, we want to direct resources that we're paying in our town for electricity bills, and we want to make sure that we're directing them to, you know, far offshore wind projects or hydropower or a solar installation. So that's one piece we've worked on. A second is around, I've worked with constituents on the Mid-Cape around how do you have solar installation on homes in historic districts. So we have quite a bit of historic districts on Cape Cod, particularly the Old Kings Highway Historic District. And so looking at how do we have a means where you have historic preservation and you're keeping the community whole in that way, but you're also providing a pathway for solar energy. And then, climate resiliency is something we're spending a lot of time trying to sink our teeth into. Cape Codders know, we're sort of on the front lines of climate change and a changing climate. We see that in our daily lives. So there's an initiative that we're trying to get the state to do around helping communities plan for, the next 20, 50, 100, 200 years out, right? The environment that we're going to be living in. That's something that's really important. So there's a whole host of issues. Another topic we've spent a lot of time on from an environmental perspective is wastewater. Wastewater is a big concern here in Mashpee. We haven't kind of kept up broadly with wastewater needs in the region. And so actually at the tail end of last session, the entire Cape and Islands delegation work to create and establish a Cape Cod and Islands Water Protection Fund, which is a subset of an existing state resource run by the Treasurer's Office and the Mass Department of Environmental Protection. And this is going to provide a funding mechanism for all the towns on Cape Cod, including Mashpee, to get help with wastewater projects. So over the life of the fund, over the next several decades, it's going to bring close to $1 billion to the region that otherwise, if we didn't have this fund, would have to be, these wastewater projects would have to be paid and borne exclusively by property taxpayers. So that's another kind of big, big environmental win. Yes, for environmental stewardship. Yes, for keeping property taxes low. And yes, for also economic development. So housing production as well. So spend a lot of time on wastewater, which I know is something that folks in Mashpee care quite a bit about.
Well, I'm really happy to hear that because on Earth Day, a lot of my friends were talking about that kind of thing and if there's anything happening to improve that. So I'm really glad to hear that that's happening.
If you look at what we sell in the global marketplace, right, the product we have is pristine water, right? That's why people come, you know, from all over the country and the world to Cape Cod, especially in the summer months. And so if we don't steward that resource, right, if we have embayments and we have ponds and estuaries that have really high levels of nitrogen or phosphorus, that's not appealing for tourists, right? And so this is sort of our bread and butter. It's an issue that we got a lot of support and help from our chambers of commerce on. And I'm glad y'all are talking about it too at the Earth Day level, because it's wonky specific stuff, but it's important.
Absolutely. So we're here at Mashpee Middle High School, and I know you're spending a lot of time working on updates to the state's education funding formula. So what are the kind of efforts you're working on with that?
So the state's education funding formula hasn't been updated since 1993, when education reform was passed. I actually was a product of that, right? So I was in elementary school and went through middle and high school with the reforms that were made in 1993. We haven't updated that, and we need to. Needs and challenges that schools are facing have changed. We have more and more students who are English language learners that we need to provide supports for them. Increasing needs and costs as it relates to special education. The cost of health care for school districts is rising and rising and rising. And the way that the state has counted low-income students really hasn't been capturing the actual need. So we're taking up an education bill. I actually serve on the education committee, which is a new appointment for me. And I actually expect that we're going to see movement in the coming months in actually taking up a bill to look at the education funding formula, to change it, to provide a roadmap around how do we bring more resources back here from municipalities. It's estimated that we are underfunding, the state is underfunding our commitment to public education by at least $1 billion every year. So that's a really big gap to close, right? You got to have conversations about revenue and how you're going to pay for that. But that's what we're in the thick of right now. And it's really focused on, you know, how do we assess low-income students, English language learners, special education, transportation also is a big piece and a big concern, especially for Cape communities. So we're in the thick of that right now. So more to come, but it is promising that we're working on it. It's long overdue.
Awesome. So how can students and all people who care about education funding most effectively make our voices heard about this effort in the coming weeks or months?
Sure. So we're actually working actively in the coming, actually next week, the Senate Chair of the Education Committee is going to be coming to the Cape, meeting with stakeholders, with superintendents, with parents, with school committee members, with some student representatives. And so we're going to be doing that. The committee has had several hearings across the state, and I think we'll have a few more. Also, if folks have ideas or thoughts, they can email me, they can email or write or call. But not only my office, but my colleague Senator Jason Lewis, who's the Senate chair, and then Representative Alice Peisch, who's the House chair of the Education Committee. Find to route that all through my office, because I serve on the committee, and so I can get that information quickly. It is a really complicated funding formula. It's so sinking your teeth into it can be tricky. But wanting to hear, I think, especially about how do we do right by our students. I'm also really interested in more broadly about how do you make sure you have supports for health and healthcare and other services in our schools. Walking over here, I passed the school nurse's office and gave your nurse a high five. Right, they do a lot of important work. But that's going to come, I think, later. This is focused right now on the actual way the state calculates need. that each community, that each school district, excuse me, has. And so that's where the real focus is. So for feedback, we're interested in what are the cost drivers that are driving costs in Mashpee and in other CAPE schools, and how can the state, where should the state be stepping in with those resources?
So the state Senate will be taking up the state budget in May. So what are you planning to work on and what are you focusing on and prioritizing?
So the budget is sort of the biggest thing we do every year. Our colleagues in the House just passed a $42.7 billion budget just yesterday, I think. In the Senate, we're going to take up our budget in May. We're focused on a whole host of things. And I really like to look at the budget. The budget's a values document, right? Because you're choosing to say, all right, where, you know, you got to put your money. Are we putting our money where our mouth is or not? So where I'm focused, I'm really focused on mental health and behavioral health. The Senate president, it's one of her most important personal priority is making sure that, is basically looking at no less than a transformational change of our mental health care system. So, you know, how we've always treated mental health is something that's been separate from either sort of acute or medical health, right? The response that we take if you, you pull your ACL or you have diabetes or a heart attack, right? Those responses are sort of different and have always been treated differently than say if you're someone struggling with depression or something more serious like bipolar and schizophrenia. So we're in the budget, we're gonna have a $10 million additional investment in mental health, in beginning to have a transformational mental health care system. Part of that's gonna be a campaign around stigma, and we're actually really talking about how mental health is a challenge we all face. This is something I've struggled with in my own life, and have family and friends who do. And I think, you know, you dig a little, you know, just a little bit below the surface, and you know, a lot of folks struggle with that, right? I think it's important that we talk about that. So that's going to be a big kind of priority and piece in the budget. Another issue, a public health issue I've been working on, relates to childhood lead poisoning prevention. Lead, if you're exposed to lead, especially if you're a really little kid, so sort of zero infants to 3, 4, 5 years old, really can have some serious detrimental impacts around learning disabilities and cognitive function. It's a big issue in the 80s and 90s, folks will remember this issue. We've forgotten about it. I'm working to secure a pretty big boost in funding for those initiatives to help on that front. And then a whole host of local priorities that we're trying to continue funding, everything from supports for firefighter departments. There's a great program we've helped fund to provide mental health and resiliency work in our schools. They're doing work in the Mashpee Public Schools. So that's just a taste of it, but it's you know, there's a whole host of things we're working on, and it's really an exciting time. It's sort of the sort of one of the busiest times that we have, and there's a lot of opportunity to do a lot of good. It's also challenging because you only have a certain amount of resources and you have to make decisions about what you do with those resources.
So would the mental health implications be implicated the same way in all of the schools across Massachusetts?
So I think what we're looking at is several things. One is an anti-stigma campaign. Yes, in schools, but also outside of schools. Yes, in the general, you know, population. Kind of akin to what we did in the height of the opiate epidemic. Which is something we're still working, you know, working through, and you know, is a significant concern, remains a significant concern, but really sort of working to reduce the stigma of mental health, just like, you know, akin to what we did with the opiate epidemic. I think it's also going to look at how do we make sure that we're providing a continuum of care for people. So often, if you're someone who's needing mental health care of any sort. It's really something that you have to be your own advocate for, and there's not a lot of connection between various services. So we're taking a look there. Conversations about what's called ambulatory mental health care as well. So if you're someone who's having an acute mental health health crisis, right now the only option you really have is to go to an emergency department. There might be other options where people can where we can support and people can go to get that help. So it's just the start of a big initiative. If anything, actually, I'm still in sort of a fact-finding mode. So aside from the budget, right, we're making this initial $10 million investment, but also looking to hear what are the challenges that, you know, Cape Codders are facing. How do we really improve mental health access and care? Down here, a lot of that's about workforce, right? Just finding a psychiatrist or a therapist that takes your insurance is a whole day's worth of work. And that's a challenge there too. So we're sort of just at the beginning of this. So stay tuned for more, you know, some initial stuff in the budget and then more to come as we're working on legislation.
Is there any way that you suggest that people reach you about that except for email, or is email the best way?
So you can reach me by phone, email, come to office hours, actually, that we had earlier today in Mashpee. My email is a really good way to reach us. You can reach me directly at julian.cyr@masenate.gov. The phone number for my office is 617-722-1570. So, you know, just give a call, you know, and then look for opportunities where we're having office hours or we're in the community. I think there'll be some community hearings and listening sessions that we'll do in the Mental Health Substance Use and Recovery Committee as well. But the more feedback, the better. I was just with a constituent earlier today who highlighted challenges between the foster care system and the mental health care system, and that, you know, the two systems aren't talking to each other. And so, you know, that's given me some homework to go try to figure out how do we. You still have homework after high school. You know, that's given me some homework to do to figure it out. So those are ideas that I wouldn't necessarily be aware of. So that's some of the information I'd like to hear, which helps us make better policy to meet people's needs.
Yeah, definitely. So, I mean, that's all that we have today. Thank you for coming.
Well, there's one more thing. Skyla, you're going to be at the State House, right, in the next few weeks? Tell me about that.
So in June, I'll be at the State House for the Massachusetts Commission on the Status of Women. They're giving me an award as one of the unsung heroines in Massachusetts.
Which is a pretty big deal. I think you're one of the... How many other younger folks receive that award? Not very many.
Yeah, right? I've heard not very many.
Cool. So yeah, so it's in June, you're going to be an unsung heroine, and we'll get to see you at the State House, which is amazing. But you know, I think what you're doing as far as participating, yes, in your community, serving on the school committee, having a voice there, all of your out of school work is pretty awesome. And so I'm just glad we're going to get to honor you at the State House with a whole host of other remarkable women who are just doing incredible work in our communities across the state. So that's, I had to get that in there, you know, because you're, yeah.
I love to do it.
Had to embarrass you a little bit, but.
I love to do it. It's natural for me.
Yeah, wonderful. Well, thank you so much for sitting down with me and all you do in Mashpee. And let's do it again.
Okay, thank you.